Hey guys, it's been a while since I've been on YouTube. Decided to do a review for my friends over on the Dreadnought Dominion fan film. Went ahead and filmed for Starship Valiant, so if you guys have checked that out, awesome, cool. Leave some comments. Let us know what you guys think of that. It's pretty fun to do. If you guys haven't liked the Facebook page, go on over there, click like. Go ahead and search up the Dreadnought Dominion Facebook page. Go ahead and like that too. Let them know what you guys think of their products. Search it up on YouTube. Check them out. See what you guys think. We're going to go ahead and my friend Jeremy Minard here is going to go ahead and help me review the second episode of Dreadnought Dominion. Now, that's a Star Trek fan film. It's one you can watch on YouTube, just like Starship Valiant. And go ahead and say hi, Jeremy.
Hey, guys. Good to be here.
Oh, right on. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, brother.
That's all good.
But, yeah, we're going to go ahead and review the second episode of Dreadnought Dominion, and the episode's called Anchors Away. So far, the show has two episodes out. This is actually kind of a prequel to the very first episodes, and this is kind of just a character setup for everything. Kind of an interesting episode, a different take from most every fan film that's been out there. Some interesting characters, interesting character moments that was in this. Jeremy, what did you think of this episode?
It has its moments. For the most part, though, it was kind of visually boring in a way. In the fact that it was just them sitting around a table talking, and that's really kind of it. There was some good acting involved, for sure. There's areas for improvement in acting, but I think the more these guys get a chance to act and perfect their skills, the better they'll get.
Right.
But for the most part, it was steady. It was steady camera work. You know, it was locked off shots, which after a while, it's like give me some eye candy.
Right, right. I do think one of the things that I did like about the show. One thing about these fan films, one critique from a lot of the fans that are out there is that a lot of the films are TOS era, and that's something that a lot of fans really kind of critique, and I think it's because of the simplicity from that era and the fact that you don't have to put as much detail into it and whatnot. The thing that kind of made this episode kind of shine for me was it reminded me a lot of like the K-7 space station, the simplicity of the interior of that, like when the tribbles were there, and I think it was Cyrano Jones, I think was the character. Was it Cyrano Jones?
Yes.
Okay. It was kind of that, where they're all just kind of chilling there. And I do understand where you're kind of talking about, where it's more of a simplistic episode.
Right, and there's nothing wrong with it being simplistic like that. And this is really, it's more like a meet and greet. Mm-hmm. We're getting to see the characters, we're getting to interact with them a little bit, we're seeing how they interact with each other. And it's kind of just like getting the names down a little bit, and almost like a synopsis of what the character's going to be like.
Right. That was, I do think one of one of the highlights, I think, for me, was the ship. Now, the Dreadnought Dominion was a ship that was made, I think if you look up in the Star Trek manual from the 1960s or 70s, I'm not sure about that. See, I'm more of a next-gen type kid, so I don't know much about, the early stuff. I think I had a book from Gene Roddenberry, like the How to Make Star Trek or something like that. So I don't really know much of the early stuff, but this ship was actually taken from like the early stuff. So when I saw this ship, like that was one of the things where it's like even from the early, the kind of on the cheap fan films, you always try to look at it and say, okay, what do I like? What do I not like? And that's one thing that with this film, I really, really love the ship design, because a lot of fan films, you look at it and it's a Constitution class starship, or it's a, you know, just a, you know, they take the same old ship, but they just redress the, you know, registry number. But this ship is actually, you know, something that's very, very different. You know, and me, I'm a big Defiant fan from, like, Deep Space Nine, because it's something that you don't see all the time. And when I saw this ship, I was like, well, that's really interesting. Like, you've got the shuttle bay facing the different direction, and you've got the, you know, like a upper pylon on top of the ship, you know, kind of like the Kelvin from the J.J. Abrams movie. So I thought, you know, just from that perspective, I thought the ship was really interesting design. You know, I really enjoyed that part of the show. I thought that was really interesting, you know. What did you think of that?
I think the CGI is pretty impressive, considering what I've seen from other fan films.
Mm-hmm.
The design, there are elements I like. Mm-hmm. There's elements that are, to me, a little bit distracting. I love having that, like you were talking about, the that extra pylon. That is really cool. Mm-hmm. This thing, it just kind of screams it has more power
right.
than your regular Constitution class.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, really, I like it. The Shelby in the front is different. That's, you know, I've seen a couple designs where they have it go straight through the ship. It was kind of like a fighter carrier kind of thing almost, but
right.
I really like the design. They did a really good job on it.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing that I like most about this show is, like, it is something that's different. You know, it's not just, you know, like I said, you know, a lot of ships will take stock footage of, you know, like or very cheaply rendered CGI, you know, and it's like, you know, if that's within your budget, you know, that's fine. Like, a lot of fan films, like, have, like, little to no budget. So it's like, you know, you've got to do what you need to do. But with this, you know, it's like, regardless of whether it's a cheap model or kind of cheap CGI, like, it's something that you don't see, you know, out there. So I really enjoy that part of the film. I really like that. But
another thing, too, about the ship is it looks like it belongs in that universe.
Yes.
It's not like some random, like, hey, let's take random parts, put it together. Like, look, this is a Starfleet vessel.
Right.
This is something I believe could be in the original series.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah. Well, I think there were, oh, heck. Well, I remember the little book I had when I was in California. I had a book that had several different designs of ships. And, of course, I never really looked at them because I was like, that's not the Enterprise. So I didn't care. But, and maybe it's revisionist history, but I think I remember a ship that was similar to that, or maybe it was that. Like, I don't really remember, but like I said, when I saw this ship, I was just like, oh, that's really kind of cool, you know? So, I don't know. I think the design of the ship is really good, but, you know, it's, you know, like I said, it's something different, and I think that that's kind of a cool ordeal, but I don't know. I think with the, I don't know, a highlight for me for the film was, the engineer, I forget what it is. I'm terrible with names, so forgive me on that, but the engineer, the one who's sitting down there, who likes the floaties in his drink, that guy, like, everything he said, he emoted his, you know, everything he said, he came across as genuine, real. I loved his performance. Everything he said, I really enjoyed his performance. He came across as a very genuine character, very real. I really loved his performance in that. What did you think?
I liked him. Mm-hmm. And he had just enough humor to make him relatable.
Mm-hmm.
That he's more human. He's not just straight up military. For me, the best character of the thing was the Admiral. She was the smoothest with her lines. She emoted. When I'm watching this, I'm looking at this and I'm believing she's an admiral.
Right.
And I'm believing she's in this world, and I'm believing that she's interacting with the characters. And that was fantastic to see that. That was by far, I think, the best character that they had so far.
Right, and that's one of the things that people don't understand. Like, when you're doing on screen work like that, a lot of it's like green screen stuff. You're working against yourself. You're not
right.
Like, you're not working against that person. You're not sitting off in the background with them talking to you. Like, you're working against yourself. Doing that zombie film that I did online, you know, with just my video camera or with just my cell phone, you know, like, you're having to just work against yourself, pretending they're talking to you and whatnot, you know. So basically, you know, you're working against yourself. So for someone that was basically talking to herself, she did a damn good job, I thought, you know, very, very talented actress.
There are ways of getting around that too. Like, you pull in the captain, or I'm sorry, the Commodore, while you're filming her scene, and you have a Mac back and forth, and you'll get a lot better. Then you're not having to play against yourself. You have someone you can play against.
Right.
And it just brings out a better performance.
Mm-hmm.
Just a little tip and trick there.
Right. Yeah, I really enjoyed her performance, too. I bought her character. Like, everything she said, I was like, you know, yeah, I agree with you completely. I think another character was the executive officer. I thought he was a pretty decent character. When he came in there, I kind of bought his character, too. I thought he was, I don't know, I kind of a likable guy. I don't know about the command style, but it was just more like, I liked him. Right off the bat, you kind of just got that kind of charming kind of guy, you know?
If we're talking about the same, you're talking about the old XO, right?
No, the younger XO. Yeah.
The younger one, he did well.
Mm-hmm.
I think with what they had to work with, you think he did really well. That sounded bad. Sorry.
Right. It's second episode, not the first one.
He did well, mm-hmm. And I think he's young enough that, you know, the character is young enough that they can. He's kind of a blank slate. They can mold him and change his character. Kind of, if you get my meaning,
mm-hmm.
on that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like I'm trashing him. I'm not trying to.
Right on.
But he's a young character, and you can take that anywhere you want to.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great thing to have.
Mm-hmm. So what was there any other character that stood out to you that you really just enjoyed, or what did you think of the just character interaction, or what did you think of the episode as a whole? Because I think with this episode, because this was, it was kind of confusing when you were watching it, because for me personally, and I know you were the same way, like you'd watch the very first episode, which was Haunted. And then I watched this one, which was Anchors Away, and this was actually meant to be three episodes total: the first one, the second one, and then the third one. But they were shot out of order. This one was actually supposed to be watched first, and then it was supposed to be Haunted, and then you're supposed to watch the third one. So it's actually part of a trilogy, but we're watching them out of order. So in that regard, it's kind of confusing. But I really wish what they had done, or I think one thing that would have made it kind of better would be as if they had done what was kind of done on Starship Valiant, was if they had put this kind of as a special edition, like at the beginning of Haunted, and made it a special edition. I think this would have made that episode that much better, because there are really good elements to this, and there's a lot of good elements to Haunted, and I think it would have made both of those just completely shine in an element that neither one of them, per se, shine on their own and independently, if that makes sense. Does that make sense to you?
Yes. And the fact that it was shot out of order, or released out of order, it really took me... It took me a while to get into... It took me a while to get into Anchors Away. Mm-hmm. Because it's like, wait a minute. This was covered already, wasn't it? And it basically kind of was in a couple of chats here and there throughout the first episode. Mm-hmm. And they were going backwards, and it really took me the moment. And that's hard to get back. It's hard when you take somebody out of the moment. It's really hard to get the audience back into it and to have that suspension of disbelief.
Kind of retread old ground that you've already kind of covered, right?
Yeah, well, it wasn't that they retread ground, and that's fine. If they had put this one first, and then, you know, and then put it in proper order, the first one would have been them actually getting together. The second one could be like a reminder. Yeah, this is what happened, and now we're going forward. But it's like, this is what happened, now we're going backwards.
Mm-hmm.
And that really kind of threw me for a loop for a while.
Mm-hmm. So it kind of took you out of the project, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So on a whole, did you like the characters? Did you like the crew?
I liked parts of the crew. Mm-hmm. So this is going to be kind of hopefully not too painful.
Okay.
There were some of the characters that really, really shined for me, like the Admiral. the XO and the engineer, they really shined. The other ones, there's room for improvement. And I understand that this is a fan film and they don't have the budget and the resources to come up with, like, J.J. Abrams.
Right, right.
There's always, even in J.J.'s, even if you are Spielberg or J.J. or Zack Snyder, there's always room for improvement. You can always learn something new.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that they have learned some great lessons from what they have done and can apply that into the next episode and just knock it out of the park.
Right. And so that's one thing about, like when I was watching it, like I saw a lot of the characters and I was like, oh, that's really good. And then I saw other things with the character and I was like, oh, that's really good. Like, especially, like I said, with the engineer, I really bought that character. And I was just like, okay, this guy can shine. And there were elements, especially like with the first episode, and we'll cover more grounds because I'm going to be doing the first episode. Will you join me on that one when we review that episode?
Absolutely.
Okay. Good deal, because I really enjoyed discussing these fan films with you. I know we've discussed it plenty of times on our own. Well, I really appreciate the help on these, brother. But like we've discussed on the other episode, and I liked the first episode more than I enjoyed this one. Is that something we both can agree on?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm not saying this one's bad. I'm just, the other one I enjoyed more because I felt like it was more of a character study, even though it was focused. And we can't go into too much depth on that one because I promised no spoilers on that one because I don't want to give it away. But it's more of a character study, and I enjoy that one. Like, I enjoy character studies more. But the thing with this, like, I saw glimpses with characters, and I see so much potential with this that it could be, and I saw more of that with the first one. So I'm excited for the third one if they can just, it's almost like your shoe's untied, and if you can just pull on it, you can just unravel the whole thing. And I think with this, they could unravel, well, that's a bad analogy. God, I'm really bad at analogies. But the whole thing needs to come unraveled. God, I suck at this. But you see what I'm saying, don't you? If they could just tug on that one thing, the whole thing could just, you know, just...
Play a diamond in a rough.
Exactly, yes. Yes, yeah, see...
We've got to chip away the rough edges to get to it, and then we need to cut the diamond to get the maximum amount of shine out of it, and then you got to polish it, and they'll have something... It's going
to
be amazing.
See, this is why I need you. Because me, I suck at analogy. I'm tugging at shoes, and you've got diamonds in your hand. I don't know what I'm talking about. So, no, like, and that's exactly it. I see a lot of diamonds there, you know, that could be. You know, and it's like, it's one of those things where it's like, there's enough there that keeps me coming back to where when they post a video saying, hey, we got another one, I'm like, okay, I'll go back and check it out. You know, let's see what we got. You know, we're no offense. If all they had was a CGI ship, that wouldn't bring me back. I'd be like, I can go look at, you know, renderings online. So that's not what's bringing me back. The characters, and those glimpses of, hey, this is what we got coming. That's what's drawing me back. The glimpses of, hey, they've got two really good character studies here. Now let's tell some adventures and some good story. Like, I'm really eager to see where this crew goes. I mean, how about you? Are you?
Considering what I know about the cast and crew, I think it's one of the better ones I've seen.
Mm-hmm.
One of the better fan films that I've seen, and knowing the adversity they have gone through, I think this is pretty good.
Right.
I think if they can get in maybe some more people who can help point them in the right direction,
mm-hmm.
I think they could have some really good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And if they can, you know, get really good stories down, you know, the character-driven stories, this is going to be amazing.
See, I agree with that completely. It's kind of one of those things where it's like, if you have, you know, you can have all the best funding in the world. You can have the J.J. Abrams, you can have the Steven Spielbergs, you can have all the, you know, you can have all the people in the world, but if you don't have nothing behind it, you just got nothing but, you know, it's like those people don't really impress me, because it's like, you know, like people like Michael Bay, people who are visually great, that doesn't really impress me. If the heart is not into it, then I don't care. Like, and that's one reason why it's like, you know, despite, like, my brother-in-law, he loves Transformers and Michael Bay. He loves Michael Bay. Now, me, I don't. Because to me, I look at that, I'm like, I see a lot of explosions. And,
you know, I agree with that. I do enjoy the Transformer movies. Please don't hate or judge me. It's not because when I'm watching them, I'm not looking to change my life.
Right.
I want to see shit explode. So it's like, oh, I'm going to watch Michael Bay movie because I just want that Carl, you know, violent type thing at the moment. If I want a good story, I will go somewhere else.
We'll see.
So there's a room for everyone in here, but something that, and I might get excommunicated from the Church of Star Trek for this, but George Lucas had this great quote of, a story, or a special effect without a story is worthless.
And then he went ahead and broke that rule with the prequels, right.
Exactly, but you can see in the original trilogy, there was story, there was conflict, right. There was resolution, and all this great stuff, and then he broke his rule, and you can see in the first three, if you will, the second trilogy part, how terrible it was without the story. They relied too much on the special effects.
Right. And that's...
I'd rather watch a movie with no special effects and get something out of it than watch Michael Bay and go, yay!
And that,
what's next.
And that's exactly it. Like that's the thing, like, I can sit there and defend a Michael Bay movie because I can sit there and go, hey, you know, his movies generally are the same movie over and over and over. And once you realize that, they're no longer impressive. My brother-in-law was like, they're, no. I'm like, well, yes, they are. They're about the low man who overcomes an obstacle and has to overcome the big, it's about the low man who has to overcome the huge obstacle, and that's it, and explosions in between. And he was like, I was like, Transformers, that's what it is. And I named off like three movies, and it was like the same premise. And he was like, dude, you're right. I'm like, I know. Once you get past that, it's nothing but eye candy. And I don't like that. And when I look at this film, it's like, I wouldn't care if it was nothing but, you know, ships on a string going across. You know, it's like, I see a lot of good, you know, I see a lot of good potential with these characters, and I want to continue the story with these guys. You know, it's like, the acting may not be top-notch, you know, Hollywood caliber, but I see the potential that each one of these characters could have, and I really want to follow these guys. I think it has a lot of potential with them, you know, and it's I really want to follow these guys and see where they go, you know, which is a lot of fan... And I follow a lot of films out there, a lot of fan films, especially given the fact that, you know, I'm in one, you know, and I want to see, you know, I want to see every one of them succeed, because it's like, since there's no Star Trek on TV... And the movies, you know, those 2 hours of movie will only take you so far. It's like, I want to see every one of these fan films succeed. Not because, you know, oh, I want to put my name out there or something, but because I want to, as a fan, I want to see good talent, not good talent, but I want to see good, you know, quality stuff out there that I can enjoy, you know. And it's like, when I see, you know, people out there who are enjoying themselves and they're putting stuff out that's good, it's like, dude, I get off on that. I love that, you know? So that's more thrilling than a Michael Bay movie, you know?
Right. So, and I think with Dreadnought Dominion, I think given the proper the proper push, you know, given the proper direction, I think these guys could be one of the better ones out there.
I do too. I do too. Especially, I'm. The thing about it is, like, the acting talent may not be like as high caliber as some of the other ones out there, like Star Trek Continues or Star Trek Phase Two or like some of those ones out there. And obviously, those ones are the higher caliber, or Axanar. You know, those ones. You know, of course, they have the budgets. They have the higher. You know, those are the higher production values. So these ones, you know, like Dreadnought Dominion, you know, they don't have the budget that's there. And that, you know, I am very forgiving. As a fan, I look at that, I'm like, I'm very forgiving. I don't care about those things because I look at the story. But more importantly than the budget, I look at the chemistry with the cast. And I see that between a lot of the characters, there is chemistry and there's potential chemistry. And so it's just, there is so much as a fan that I look at and I'm like, there is a lot of potential there. And with this episode, and more so with the first episode, I really think that, I don't know. I think there's a lot of potential there. I think with this story, did this story necessarily need to be told? Not really, but it's not bad as a filler episode. I think this could have really been, like I said, tacked on to maybe the beginning of the first episode and been probably re-released as a special edition. Like I said, not to pull it back over to Starship Valiant, but I think what Michael did was very smart. Put that as a special edition and then re-released it, you know, as something that was, hey, boom, here you go. Especially given that this was the first episode of Dreadnought Dominion was, I think the runtime for this was like 13 minutes. You know, 13 minutes for a special edition, you know, that's not very bad. You know, that's not bad at all. And I think the first episode, I think the runtime on that was, I think, 37 minutes, I think, if memory serves. So you would have had, you know, about an hour episode for your first episode if you would have re-released it as a first edition. I think that would have really made your first episode stand out. So that's what I would have done differently. But I don't think either one of these two pieces on their own are necessarily bad. And again, like I said, I think there's a lot of potential with this film.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
I think if you were to combine the two together, there's some areas you could have trimmed out. Because you're kind of repeating yourself,
right?
Between the two, and that would have shortened it down a little bit. Because if you make it too long, people are gonna lose interest. So always leave your audience wanting more.
Mm-hmm.
So if they had cut down some of the earlier conversation and took out that little bit in episode one, where it's like, okay, this is what happened. Now let's get to the bridge. They could have cut that out. It could have shortened it up a little bit, made it a little tighter, made it a little smoother. And it could have, yeah, I think you're right. It would have made it a very awesome, like, special edition episode.
Yeah, it would have been one of those ones where you could have sat down and been like, I've seen all, you know, you got on Netflix and you're like, well, I've already seen all the original series. I've seen all Next Gen. I'll go to YouTube. I'll watch this. You know, I mean, it would have made a really good first episode, you know, special edition, and it would have made everyone kind of been like talking, like, wow, that's something really cool. You know, maybe, you know. You know, fix the sound, you know, fix, you know, maybe a special effect here and there, you know, something. Because that's something, that is one critique about this that I would really work on is the sound. There was a couple sound bites that were kind of cringeworthy, that were, you know, as a fan, it's like some of those fans out there are really kind of unforgivable. You know, where it's like they'll hang you by your teeth if you give them the time of day to do that. But it's like that's one thing I would have taken the time, you know, because you could tell they put the time into this episode. You know, if they had put this into a special edition, fixed the sound for both the episodes and just combined it into one, oh, it would have been a hell of an episode. This would have really been a great thing, I think. You know,
as an audio guy, as a set recordist, you know, that's what I do. I go into a set and I record audio. One of the things I do. This was really hard for me to get through because I know the importance of audio.
Mm-hmm.
Audio is like... And some people may disagree with this, but audio is literally 70% of the show. If
right.
it sounds like crap, no one's going to watch it. If it looks like crap, but they can hear it well, they'll still watch it. They'll be forgiving because maybe these guys didn't have the fancy cameras to get what they needed. But part of the problem with me being able to stick with parts of the episode was I couldn't understand what was being said. It was too soft. Someone had their back turned and they didn't ADR ADR his line and put it in post. It makes it really hard, and people just will not stick that out.
Right.
So it's super, super important that you get the best audio you can. And if you have to catch a second take of it, because someone's back is turned and you need to catch that line, take that 2 seconds to do it, and you'll have such a better program, and everyone will stick around a lot longer just to watch what you've put out.
Or the trolls will stick it out, and then they'll they'll lynch up, and
See, and here's the thing with keeping your audience engaged: if they can stay in the moment, they'll be a lot more forgiving.
Yeah.
When they get out of the moment is when they start nitpicking and tearing everything apart. And audio is a huge thing with that.
Yeah.
Audio is a it's an invisible art, as they like to say, and you don't even know it's there until something's wrong.
Right.
And the second the audio is screwed up, that's when they start noticing other things like, hey, this door didn't close right, or hey, this set looks a little bad. And not that their stuff was like that, but well, it gives them a reason to, it pulls them out of the moment, and it gives them a reason to start tearing apart everything that doesn't even need to be mentioned.
Well, it makes it seem like when your audio is off, it makes it seem like you don't care. Regardless of whether you do or not, it makes it seem like to them, it makes it seem like you just flip them off and you don't care. And what's sad is you can tell that the people that produce this show really do care and that they are trying to put their all into it. And so if one or two things can make or break your film.
Bunch of little things. It doesn't have to be anything huge. I mean, big things are bad too.
Right.
But the little things are what will really kill you, because, like I said, if this was a little out of focus, or if the visuals were, like, grainy, I can forgive that, because, you know, they may not have had a Red Epic Canon or a Red Epic camera to shoot with. They may have had a DSLR. They may have just had a cell phone to shoot this with. I can forgive that. But if the audio is bad, that grates on my nerves, not just because I'm an audio guy, but it's like, come on, I can't even hear what you're trying to tell me, so you're wasting your breath telling me a story I can't hear.
Well, I listen to a lot of podcasts. That's one of those things, like, I love, you know, if I'm out jogging or I'm out, you know, lifting weights when I go to the gym, like, I have my MP3 player and I listen to a lot of podcasts, and that's one of those things where it's like, if the volume's too low, I'm like, screw it, and I'll go to the next podcast. I don't even listen to it. And these are, you know, I listen to a lot of regular ones. Regular, you know, there are select ones that I listen to on a regular basis. But it's like every once in a while, like, I'll flip to a different one, and, you know, I'll download that one and I'll listen to it. But it's like if the audio is crap, I never go back to that one. And it's like it might be a one that I just happen to download, and it might have been a fluke for them that, oh, shoot, it recorded bad this week. But it's like all it takes is one for me to be like, well, I'm never going back to that one, and it doesn't matter if it was a fluke or not. And it's like, that's one of those things where it's like, it just takes one for me to not go back, and it doesn't matter. It's kind of like when you have a bad experience at a fast food restaurant. Some people are that nitpicky. They won't come back. And sadly, because we have so much media at our fingertips, you know, especially with YouTube, Netflix, Hulu, you know, cable is finding that out more than anybody, that you can go anywhere and get media. We don't have to buy cable.
Yeah.
And it's like, you know, fan films are the same way. How many, you know, 10 years ago, YouTube really wasn't a big thing. Now we have so much Star Trek out there where it's almost an oversaturation. You get lost among the fan films. So it's like if your audio is crap, or if your special effects are, if it looks like you don't care, then they'll go to someone that is. And unfortunately, that means like films like Axanar or Star Trek Continues, or, you know, one of the higher ones where, you know, these people have the huge budgets. And sadly, it puts, you know, the ones, you know, the other ones to shame, that, you know, those are the fan films. Because it's like, as much as I love, you know, the big budget ones or the ones that have big budgets, you know, I don't really consider those ones fan films, because when you have a budget that is bigger than what I make in a complete year, I don't really consider that a fan film, you know? I mean, let's just call it what it is. That's a small budget film. I mean, that's what it is. When I look at a film like this, or I look at a film like Starship Valiant, or a film like Starship Exeter, you know, that is a fan film. Those are films made by fans. You know, I'm not saying those other ones aren't fan films. I'm just saying the level quality is completely different. You know, so it's like,
we're thinking of fan films as low to no budget, and you're thinking of like an Axanar that's higher budget, so it could have been from a studio.
Right. And it's like it's one of those things where it's like, if you don't have good sound, or you don't have, you know, if it looks like you don't care or you're not trying, they're not gonna give you the time of day, because they'll just go somewhere else. And so it's one of those things where it's like, if these people had a budget, well, not budget per se, but if these people had just a little bit more time for their product, I would love to see what these people could do with that, you know? And that's, I really hope this product can get out there and can get something that just, I don't know, like I see a lot of potential in this product, you know, I really do.
I agree. And you actually touched on something that's super important. You're absolutely right. There are, I mean, Starship, you know, whatever, films everywhere out there. It's, we almost have a full chronicle of Starfleet ship by ship by ship. There's so many fan films out there.
Yeah.
And because there's so many fan films out there, you have to have not just an audio, but you have to have something that makes you stick out. I have my choice of fan films that I can watch hours of and not even get to yours. But if you give me a reason to come and look at yours, and if it's really good, if it catches my attention, I will come back.
Yeah.
I'll come back, and I'll keep coming back. But if it's just like, ugh, I've seen this, I'm moving on, then you've lost me because I'm going to go to somebody else who's done something amazing, and that's where I'm going to stick.
Yeah. And that's the thing, like, these people... Like the fans are the most loyal people. It's, I mean, take a look at the J.J. Abrams films. Those ones, like those people, you've got some people who love the films, you've got some people that hate the films. So this is the perfect time to strike out in the fan film, especially with the modern age with YouTube and the fact that you can make your films on a low to no budget. You know, you've got GoFundMes, which honestly, I don't even really like GoFundMes because I don't really believe they help, especially when you've got, you know, actors and, professionals out there that are kind of milking the fans so that real fans out there who are trying to struggle, they don't get any of it. You know, so it's just kind of like, eh, whatever, without getting political or anything. It's like the low people are still getting nothing. So, you know, it's just, it's sad because it's like, you know, I look at films like this that could potentially, again, like you said, a diamond in the rough. I think films like this, you know, if they just could get rid of what doesn't quite work, I think it's got a lot of potential. You know,
yes.
And I think especially like, you know, not comparing it to a blockbuster like, you know, the 2009 Star Trek, but I think a lot of these fan films out there have the potential to go further than the J.J. Abrams 2009 Star Trek out there, at least in terms of character development and in terms of heart.
I completely agree with that. And you have two levels here. You have indie, which is, you know, independent, which is basically what fan films are. They're indie. And then you have the studios. Studios have all the money. They can put all the money into advertising, into the big-name actors, the big-name CGI guys like Industrial Light and Magic. I probably just screwed that name over real bad. But they have all of that stuff, and because of that, they're not willing to take chances.
Right.
They're not willing to take a chance on, well, you know, this is a good story, but is it going to sell? I don't know. Indie, that's all they have is the story.
Right.
If they don't have good story, there's no reason to go for it because, you know, there's... Like we're saying, like, there's so much out there. If I'm into a story, that's what I want. I don't care if it's got big explosions or giant fancy starships. I want a story. And that's all indie has. That's all they can have to sell. That's all they have to say, look at me. I'm different from the big Hollywood guys. I'm different from this guy because I'm doing this story.
Well, and that's the thing, like, especially with the Promenade, and again, not a cheap plug for the Promenade group, but so many of them out there, that's all they get into now. You know, back when we were growing up, like, all you could get was explosions. All you could get, like, nobody really cared about story. It was more about cheap explosions, popcorn, you know, popcorn talk. You know, that's really all people cared about. Now, people care about story. People care about character growth. And so, again, it boils back down to this is the perfect time because although there's almost an oversaturation of film, there's an oversaturation of crap. And so if
yes.
You've got something that is good and you've got something that's unique, then you've got a chance to shine. And you've got a chance, you know, although none of us can make money off these films, because I mean, let's face it, you can't make profit off Star Trek. You know, they just won't let you. And that's fine. But there's still a chance here to do something that's fun, to do something that's unique, to do something that contributes to the Star Trek universe, to do something where someone down the line can look at this and say, you know what? Never really got into Star Trek, but I watched this, and you know what? I really enjoyed that. You know, and it's like, that's where, you know, I look at these characters, and like I said, there's a lot of potential to this. And I enjoyed, like I said, I enjoyed what they were trying to set up. I don't know if it was fully executed properly. I think this would have been a really good part of a story, but I don't think the story itself was complete. And I look at that as a fellow artist and a writer in my own right. I mean, I've written a couple of things, but again, I'm not a professional, so I mean, my opinion is just that, an opinion, and I've been wrong before. Just don't ask my wife, because she'll tell you more than, you know, a few times.
That's the thing about art. It's all opinion.
Right, and that's, yeah.
It's up to interpretation, and the director has a way of interpreting it, the actors have a way of interpreting the characters, the people watching it will look at something and go, I see it this way. You know, it really comes down to what the writer had in mind. And that's what everything comes down to. If you have good writing, that's like the foundation right there. If you have good writing, with good scripts, everything else should fall into place.
Right. Well, I don't know. We've gone 40 minutes on this. I think we've kind of yapped long enough. We've gone in 4 more minutes, it will have been 3 times the episode. So I think we've yapped everybody's jaw off.
Half hour ago.
Right? We were only supposed to do 5 minutes. So, but I think to sum up my thoughts on the episode. Well, why don't go ahead and wrap up your thoughts on the episode. Just give us about a minute or 30 seconds. Just wrap up what, you know, the pros, cons, what you liked, what you didn't like, anything that stood out. Just go ahead and give us a real quick synopsis, brother, and then I'll wrap it up and we'll end the program.
All right. Things I liked. There were the good three characters, the Admiral, the Doctor, and Engineer.
The Doctor?
Engineer. No, not the Doctor. It was the Admiral, the Engineer. There's a third guy. Oh, the XO. The guy who is dead.
Okay, hold up. Okay, you lost me here. Okay, start from the beginning. What did you say now? What was good? Okay.
What I liked was three of the characters. There was the Admiral, the Dead XO, and the Engineer.
Those
guys were great.
Hold up. The Dead XO isn't in this one.
I know he isn't in this one. We kind of covered both at the same time, so.
Oh, okay. Okay, I see. Okay, my bad. Go ahead, brother. I'm sorry.
No worries. But those three were fantastic. They should keep them if they can. Give them expanded roles. Some of the other acting, they need help. And I understand this is a fan film. They may not have access to that kind of help that they need to get them farther. But more practice, do monologues, whatever it is you need to do to step up your acting game would really help out a lot. And then audio, that needs to be fixed. Once that's fixed, you're like halfway there to being something really, really fantastic. I think I went over my 30 seconds.
Oh. Right on. I thought you were still continuing. I was like, what? All right.
Doc!
Right on. Well, I think you're right. We did kind of cover both episodes. So I guess, I don't know, I guess we don't need to do one for the next one. So, I don't know. We may go over it again just to go more in depth. Well, yeah, we'll go over it again just to go more in depth with the story and whatnot. I thought this had a lot of promise. I look forward to seeing where these characters go, because having gone 2 episodes, I wouldn't have stuck it. You know, if I didn't see there was a lot of promise with the first episode that I watched, I wouldn't have stuck it with this one. I think there's a lot of promise with the characters. I think some of the actors are doing really good. I think some of the actors need to take cues from the ones that are doing good. I think
the writing can be stepped up just a little bit more too. It seems that some of the dialogue is overwritten.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if they were to pull it back and instead of trying to get like all this information out in one shot, maybe chop it up a little bit more into more of a conversation piece, you know, just kind of thin out the lines a little bit. Mm-hmm. I think that helped out a lot as well.
Yeah. I think where the story is going, I'm eager to see this crew finally leave.
Yes.
Because we've spent 2 episodes in dry dock or space dock. I'm eager to see this crew go explore. I'm eager to finally see this crew get out from the, post-traumatic stress, from where they were. I'm eager to see this crew finally unite and go do, whatever it is they want to go do, and I'm eager to see character-based stories. And that's what this show, I think, has set up good. A lot of fan films have set up, oh, we're going to give you explosions, and this show hasn't done that. And I like that, so I look forward to seeing properly good character-driven stories. And that's what I think is what the essence of Star Trek is character-driven stories and exploring the human condition. And that's the one thing that I think that this show has, if not properly executed, I think it's attempted to do, and that's character-driven stories. And that's what I think anyone that attempts to do so, I think, should at least be given credit for trying to do that, because at least you're attempting to do what Star Trek has done. And that's one thing that, even though people complain about Deep Space Nine, that's why I love Deep Space Nine, because it explored the human condition, and that is what Star Trek is at its core. So again, some people, hey, they may throw me out of the Star Trek camp, because some people don't even consider DS9 Star Trek, so whatever with that. But that's honestly where I stand on this series, Dreadnought Dominion. So, but anyway, my battery on my computer is about to die. So, all right, Jeremy, so you're with me for the next one, right, brother?
I'm with you for the next one, man.
All right, guys. So, all right, guys, we will catch you next time, whenever that is. No promises, no guarantees, but you guys have a good night, and keep on geeking on.